I think that's the only announcement I had to make. We get into this lecture this morning. Now, last time we finished up on all this cane pruning, all these various types of pruning, and I gave you the advantage, disadvantages. Now we've discussed all three of them. We really ought to summarize in general for just a moment these types of training pruning systems that are used in California, this head, cordon, and cane pruning. And it's actually a matter of classification of pruning systems, which is covered briefly in the text. The classification of pruning systems, and that's training pruning systems, of course. We frequently forget this, training pruning systems. And you can actually analyze these, if you like, by saying that there are about three different categories or points that you want to consider. And one of the first ones is that they differ in arrangement and amount of the old wood. In the arrangement and amount of old wood. And the best way to point this out, perhaps, is when you're referring to this as old wood, then. And if you look down on top of the vines, on a head train vine, you get this wagon wheel effect, which I've talked about so much out in class. Ideally, you'd have something that looked like that. Looking down on top of it, these then are the arms from which you get the spurs. This would be the head system. And head, train, and spur prune. But looking down on the same sort of system where you have head trained and cane prune in the vine row now, this being the vine row, you would like to have, on an ideal system, really only four arms in either an X or, you can't make an H out of a vine, but if you wanted to think of it as that, you'd have an H shape on this. But X, actually you come out with something like an X, and off of this, of course, you take your canes. Those of you had, yesterday had the cane pruning, and the rest of you get it today and next Monday. So this would be head trained, but cane pruned. And cane prune, of course, you've got to keep it in the vine row because you do have to have wires, so you don't have this possibility of cross-cultivating, which calls for this wagon wheel effect. And this means that you've got to keep the arms more or less in the vine row, as well as the spurs, which, remember, once again, that canes in cane pruning are a one-year affair, whereas spurs, when you leave a spur, you are essentially building onto the permanent framework of the vine. So this is head trained, but cane pruned over here, and this is spur pruned, and this over here, in this type. So that's arrangement old wood on that. And of course, now you have to look at it in vertical. Of course, you know the cordon is a T-shape for the cordon, with the arms, which are part of the old wood, up like this. So the arrangement of the old wood is one of the ways of classifying pruning systems. Then point B on this, somebody asked me to keep this up high so they could see. Point B on this is the difference in length of the bearing units of fruiting units, since I called it that last time, fruiting units. And we went through all this between the spurs, which may be short, medium, or long, and fruit canes, which may be short or long. So it's spurs of varying lengths, and canes of spurs of short, medium, and long, and canes, which are short, and I tell you we don't use much of this, or long under California situations. And then the ABC, the third item here, would be the arrangement of the bearing units. This is the arrangement of the old wood, and this is the arrangement of the bearing units, arrangement of the bearing unit, fruiting units. I want to get over that. And of course, arrangement of the fruiting units. And of course, on this, the spurs, of course, they're arranged usually one or two on the arms of the head. And over here, of course, you have one or more on the cordons as spurs. And of course, on the canes, you get down to a situation which we want to discuss and maybe show some slides here of how you take care of these canes. Because in cane pruning, as you saw in one or two slides, and for continuity, we're going to have some repetition here. For canes, you can have no wire at all, in which you basket them. Or you can have one wire, which is used with some wine grapes and some Thompson, and many Thompson seedless used for raisins. Or you can go to the two-wire vertical and put canes on both wires, or put canes on the bottom wire and use the top one for support, which is the more popular system today for both Thompson seedless for raisins and for wine, especially that which is planned for mechanical harvesting. Or you can go to three wires with table fruit of Thompsons, or you can go to four wires or even more. So now just to sort of summarize this whole thing up, we'll look at a series of slides on this matter of various types of ways, or various ways in which to handle cane vines. You're the light man. Okay. Now this, again, as I told you, this is the no-wire way of handling canes, which of course we don't recommend at all, but it used to be used. I guess the only way I can do this is squat down. Okay, the next slide. And this, if you can focus there, shows a system with one wire. And this was the first step we had in getting people to, in the coastal counties in particular, to go from head train to a trellis system. This shows it on one wire, but I see another wire up there above. So, but assume that this is a one-wire deal. And you see, some of you in class will express horror at the idea of putting two canes on one wire. But in raisin and wine Thompsons, where they usually frequently go to five and six canes, they may twist three on one wire, just twist them around each other like this. So it is not unusual to have it that way. Next slide. And you can see one here. See, this is a real old Thompson, pretty sad shape, but you can see they've taken three canes out of this one at the end, and they've got two canes here. So really right in this spot here, you got about five canes that are all twisted together. And you wonder how you can get any fruit out of that setup, but experience, I guess, is the best teacher, and they have been able to get fairly decent crops at a low cost under this type of arrangement, but it's not ideal. Next slide. And this is one I just took as a close-up. Looks like I took it in a dust storm, a dirty slide. But you see we got two canes coming from over here and two from over here, and they overlap by about a foot. So, and that's, I told you in class yesterday, if you're working with raisin or wine grapes, this is often the way they do it. They take them, maybe not this much overlap, but at least overlap by a couple of nodes so that you can make one tie and take care of the canes. On table fruit, they usually stop about 6 to 12 inches apart here in the middle, tie these at this end and tie these at this end. But in table fruit, it's usually just one cane on a wire. So that's one of the differences between the way you treat wine grapes and table fruit, mainly because of economics, not because of desirable viticultural practices. Okay, next slide. And it's just another example of this happens to be a two-wire trellis now. We've gone from one-wire to two-wire, and here we've got a cross-arm and canes taken onto one side or the other, but it's still basically a two-wire, but it's two-wire horizontal instead of two-wire vertical. So next slide. Boy, when I said vertical, I didn't mean put it on the ceiling. Now see, this is two-wire vertical. This is the old-style way of training Thompsons for raisins. in the San Joaquin. Again, you can begin to get an idea here what I mean about letting the head get out of shape. See, over the years, they did not leave renewal spurs. They had to use the base of fruiting canes, and the first thing you know, your head has really gone way out to here now. There's the end of it at this point, so that the head is getting completely out of shape because they did not leave renewal spurs and keep the head compact, as we were trying to show you in lab yesterday. A cane and a spur. A couple of canes here, spur back here, spur behind a cane, spur behind a cane. This one is pruned properly this year, but it hadn't been pruned properly in the past years. You see, on this one, they did not leave sufficient spurs, so they had to come out on two-year-old wood and pick up a lateral at this point to make a cane out of it. So this becomes part of the trunk, which makes a mess out of the whole thing. And you say, well, what? See here, they've taken a 2-year-old wood and left a good lateral on it and brought it out. Well, you say, well, what's so wrong with it? You keep telling me that the thing in viticulture is to make money, not to make the vines look pretty. Well, eventually, what you're really after in grapes in viticulture is the amount of grapes you can make per foot of vine row. And if you've got a foot of vine row here with absolutely no chance of getting fruit on it, you've thrown away a foot of your row. So the idea is to keep the head back in here and make every inch that you can make along the row itself be fruitful. And there's no point in having 12 inches or so of old trunk, or in this case, another 12 or 16 inches unnecessary out here that is unfruitful or unproductive to you. So this is an example of a two-wire vertical, and was very popular and very common in the many acres of Thompson seedless in the San Joaquin Valley for years, or it started out that way. But then growers, the original idea was that growers would put their canes on this wire only, and then let this be a foliage support wire. And that's what we're trying, of course, now, and is fairly common with the new plantings of wine varieties. But the Thompson seedless growers in many areas found out by experience that when they put their wires, their canes on this wire, and you had an unusual cold period in the early spring, they often got frosted because cold air drifts down to the bottom just like water flowing. And they found out that if they put their canes on the upper wire, then they often escape frost. So many of them then went to one wire. They just put the canes on the upper wire, and they said, well, if we don't use the bottom wire to put canes on, why have it? So then many of them went to just one wire. And you'll still find lots of vineyards of that type. But that's the reason they started out with two wires and then went to one. And now they're coming back to two because of mechanical harvesting. They started out with two, it seemed practical. Then they went to one because experience showed them that they had a better batting average against frost the higher they put their canes. Now they're coming back to the two wire and putting them on this one because of the necessity for mechanical harvesting. And next slide. Now we go to Table Thompson's, and this is one view of a four-wire sloping trellis, such as you were working with yesterday. Many times it's only three, but on Table Thompson's it's usually four, two, three, four. And when you have four wires with Table Thompson's, you usually only have four canes. And look again here, it's an idealistic situation where you had the spur that I talked about last time, where you leave the terminal as a cane and the one behind it as a spur. The terminal as a cane, the one behind it as a spur, and so on. Now, some of you took me too literally on this in pruning yesterday and said, well, I can't find a spur right here to go with that cane. I've got to take one over here. And I said, well, that's all right, as long as you match them up one for one. And in some cases, you don't need to leave even numbers. If you don't have enough, you can leave four canes and three spurs. I say many commercial growers may cut it down to four and two, but you'd like to leave up to as many spurs as you have canes if you have good selection. But if you have a four-wire system, of course, the deal is to put the canes on the two middle wires so that I'll show you later. Maybe I can show you long enough here. This is a sloping trellis, and so that when you put them on these two middle wires, the shoots from this one hopefully will grow up and fall over this side, and these will go over and fall over like this and let the fruit hang free in here to work on. If you put them on the very top wire or the very bottom wire, you get the same effect as though you only had a one-wire trellis. They just grow up and fall over. So on a four-wire deal, you want to put them on the middle wire. Well, yeah, on this, he asks, where are the prunings be made the following year? Here's a two-bud spur. Hopefully, it'll have two good canes on it. We'll cut this off and throw it away. And then we'll have two canes on here, and hopefully, we'll use the terminal one as a cane and the basal one as a spur. You just alternate the situation. Okay, next slide. And this is just looking down the vine row to show you how nicely it looks when it's done properly. This is a four-wire trellis, one, two, three, and four. You can't see them, but you can see down the line, sometimes you don't get four canes. But in general, you get four canes, and they're very neatly and nicely placed on the middle two wires of a Table Thompson vineyard. Perhaps here's the best way to look at it on this particular one here. Two canes going this way, two that. Two here, and one, and a short one. No, I guess it comes down there somewhere. So this is a beautiful shot, or a beautiful vineyard, not a beautiful shot perhaps, but a beautiful vineyard in the Arvin area down near Bakersfield where the early Table Thompsons are produced. Next slide. Now this shows you some of the benefits of the cane pruning and the four-wire setup. I told you that cordons, when you spread out a cordon, you spread out the fruit, but you still have it only basically on one wire. But when you go to cane pruning system and put the canes on the two middle wires, you see how nicely the shoots are exposed. And notice also how many of them break, and each one of these probably has a potential of two clusters on it. And notice also in here how much growth you get, so that you don't want to overdo this idea of leaving spurs because you don't want a real mass of growth in there. So certainly, equal to the canes, or slightly less than the number of canes, is sufficient. It also gives you an idea why the basal buds on Thompson are not fruitful, because I told you, some of you in that Monday afternoon bull session, that Thompson seedless will not fruit at a bud that does not, where its leaf does not get sunlight. And you can see that many of these basal buds in this area are not going to get sunlight, basal leaves, later on in the season. This is a Table Thompson, you can tell by the girdle marks, four wire, sloping trellis, the canes, two in each direction, put it on the middle wire, it really spreads the fruit out this way and the other, and crossways also. Next slide. And this is just a close-up of one half of that vine to show you what it's going to look like. Those of you pruned and yesterday and pruned today get some idea what you're going to be working with later on in the summer. And you can see the clusters are forming here. Usually a couple per shoot, one or more per shoot on these canes. Okay, next slide, and I think, that was a four-wire system on a sloping trellis. Here's an improvement, we think. In fact, I think that this is the best compromise between the various systems that we're working with today. Lighter and cleaver seem to be going for more elaborate trellises. Those two boys who are going to work this afternoon are going to be working with them on what I call their slingshot system, in which they're putting up about five or six wires in a open U shape. But this gives you the cross arm two wires to support the four canes, spreading them out this way as well as this way, and gives you support up above to take care of the foliage. The point of this thing is that this cross arm should be 6 to 12 inches shorter than the one up above, because what you really want is a lot of leaf exposure, which means that you want to make this whole foliage vase-shaped, or an open flowered shape, open rose shape, so that if you make this cross arm here, this one up above the same as this one, you're going to have a rigid system that goes up too tightly and keeps it too vertical. You want it to go up and fall over and spread out to expose as many leaves as possible to get the most energy possible for fruit production. And we all look at these out in the field. This was taken right out here in Davis, or in our own vineyards. So it's a part of the problem of these tests that are being carried on in various trellis systems. And I think this is probably the most economical and yet the most beneficial system that we can work with under our present day conditions. four wires. Originally, when they started this, they put three wires on top. And then they found out very quickly this defeated the whole purpose, because that middle wire caused everything to cling to it. These shoots that grew up from here caught that middle wire first and tended to stay erect. They didn't fall open and expose all the basal leaves to the sun. So they very quickly got around the idea of yanking off that middle wire on top. So two below and two above, the two above spread out a little wider. Seems to be a pretty good training system, okay? Not very much yet. What we're having trouble, a lighter and goes out and gives these talks and so forth and shows his data, showing how you can improve yields by these various systems. But remember, it took us 20 years to get them to go from a head-trained vine to one wire in the coastal counties. And then when we got them from one wire to two wires, we thought we were really great. To get them to go to four wires is going to be something else. Yes?
You said it was more economical to put two over two that way?
Than some of these more elaborate ones that they're working on now. At least it seems to me this is a better compromise deal. These elaborate ones they're working on now really go far out. Sure, they'll increase yields, and as land becomes more expensive, or if grapes stay the same price they are, more and more people will go to putting in more money to build these more elaborate ones. For example, here's one in which we've got one, two, three, four wires up on top of a trellis. We have four on top, and then down below along here on alternate stakes, we have a support wire for the cordon. So this one goes from a cordon support wire to four wires, so it's a five-wire system with a cross arm at 7 feet at one vine, and the next one at 5 feet, and seven and five down the line. So this is just another type of a way to handle canes and bearing units, which is what this slide series is supposed to be carrying out. Okay, next slide. And here we go to some new work by Dr. Nelson, in which eventually he plans to put one, two, three, four, five, six wires on a sloping trellis on a 5-foot cross arm. Now, if that sounds fantastic, remember that in South Africa, for example, they have sloping trellis that are so long they go up and then they tie onto the next vine trellis and a little short hip roof sort of deal and go up, over, up and over in a continuous trellis system. So that we know that the more leaves that are exposed to the sun, the greater the capacity of the vine to produce fruit or wood. That's obvious. Green leaves are the only factory the vine has, and the factory doesn't run unless sunshine hits the leaves. It's a question then of making studies on how much benefit you can get on these cost factors, which you were talking about, on how far you want to go on some of these elaborate trellises. So there's a six-wire potential, three, four, five, six. So you can go from no wires up to at least six under the vineyard plantings that you can see in California. The next line, I think that may be all the series. Yeah, that's all the series on that. Okay, let's have the lights and turn this one off, if you would, please. Now, one thing, just while we're talking about this matter of trellising, which always gets me a little bit, is because I was caught on it myself once, is that you make the statement that the more leaves which are exposed to the sun, the more energy and more sugar, therefore, the vine can produce. So you'd say to yourself, well, then the best way to do this is make a complete overhead trellis. I'll space these out properly. And if we do that like the winter vine and cover all of this with foliage, so that this is in complete shade underneath the vine, that ought to be about as complete as you can get for intercepting all the sunlight. That's what you think at first thought. But that isn't the way it works, because if you build these fairly high cross-arm trellises and say take this double cross-arm like this, and the higher you can get this, and then the canes are tied on this wire and the shoots go up and go up 12 or 18 inches, and then they fall over and they come clear down to the ground like this. Now suppose this is 5 feet. And this cross arm up here may be at the maximum, say 30 inches or 2.5 feet, 30 inches, and this is 5 feet, and you're going to get foliage, of course, all through here, or cane growth, so that you get enough sunlight coming in from the morning in here, and during the early, late morning, during noontime, early afternoon, and late afternoon in here, you're getting this vine hit with sunlight over this whole area as compared to a overhead trellis, which is just that much. Yeah.
Isn't that when you're assuming that the vines are lined up going north-south?
Well, either way, in the growing season, on north-south, actually what I'm showing you is east-west, because this would be in the morning in the east, and then come up to noon, and here'd be west. So actually, it's looking at it with vines growing east and west. Actually, north and south, it'd probably be better. If you think of the sun going this way, you still get enough light penetrating all the way through this and over the top and down the other side, too. So either way, east or west, you get more total exposure of leaves to some effective sunlight in this high, open vase type growth, going up and over like this, than you do with an overhead trellis, which sort of startles you at first. You think that when you make complete shade under here, that that's the most complete interception of sunlight you can get. But the grapevine, one of the things that makes this thing work is that the grapevine, grape leaf, is at its maximum efficiency, there's no higher efficiency after it intercepts about one-third of the normal spring, summer, early fall total sunlight. In other words, our total sunlight is measured at something like 10 to 11,000 foot candles during the summer, and we can get our maximum efficiency or no greater efficiency after we get up to about 3 or 4,000 foot candles of light actually hitting the leaf. So if it has to filter through some foliage to get into the second and third leaf, it's still going to get enough exposure to make it effective photosynthetically to its maximum capacity. So this thing, for several years, I went along with the idea that this was the best way to get the most efficient use or most complete use of the sunlight you could get. And then when you come to think about it a little bit, you get a different idea, especially after you get the data which shows that a third to 40% of the total light impinging on a leaf, grape leaf, is all that that grape leaf really needs or can utilize. Okay, that then sort of is the end of this matter of the various types of training systems and pruning systems. And now we got to get into the thing that you got a little bit of quiz on last time about the so-called principles of pruning as they apply to grapes. And this will be the rest of the morning lecture. This is just as a little bit of a word of background. Some of you know Professor Winkler. Some of you know that he's been working with the department for about 40 years. And when he first came in the department, his first big research project was to work out this matter of principles of pruning. So that's his pride and joy. So don't ever knock him on it. But a lot of this whole theory and concept of why you prune and what it accomplishes had really not been understood thoroughly before. So that over the first 15 or 20 years of his career, he worked on really what is boiled down in his final net results into these principles of pruning, which are discussed in this chapter on pruning. And originally these were published in a bulletin, which is no longer in print now, but it's called Bulletin 89 in the experiment station. It's out of print. And he used to have about 15 of those rules in there. And by hammering and hammering and hammering at him and so forth, we finally boiled him down to where he has about 7 that are those that are listed in italics in the text. And some of you apparently didn't get them on this quiz. And in past years, I have gone laboriously through about 3 or four lectures going into the great details of each one of these principles of pruning with illustrations and so on. But I think with this class, you can read as well as I can. And I spent quite a bit of time last night going over this chapter again. And I think I'm going to try something new and different in this class and try to cut this whole discussion on principles of pruning down to certainly not more than a lecture and a half. So I'll hit some of the things which I've found out in the past confuses you, and then maybe we'll have a little question and answer period to clear up some of the other points. Now, the first point, of course, is this, and the most important thing is you've been told before that pruning is depressing. Pruning is depressing on the vine. And it's depressing, actually it's depressing on the, pruning is depressing or dwarfing or limiting, whatever you want to call it, on both vine growth and fruit. And on fruit production. And what I tell you the combination of these two is, we call the combination of these two capacity. So it's pruning reduces the capacity, but I want to touch on that a little bit later. All right, let's have a slide, which is the one in the textbook, which just to sort of tie this thing together. Here's the one that's in the text. And you see the way Winkler worked this, he had a set up a situation which he had vines in which he took off all the crop. All the flowers, as soon as they came out, he'd pull them all off. And then he gave one series normal pruning, no crop at all, just normal pruning, and another series severe pruning, which means he left them only the basal buds on it. Now here's the unpruned vine, which he didn't prune it at all. He just took all the fruit off of it. So this vine was wild, free, and happy. Had no work to do at all. It just had to grow. So using that as 100% as a relative measure, here's the relative growth. It's a relative thing. Just normal pruning alone and no fruit on it at all. Cut down the total wood produced in that year by 25%. And if you gave it severe pruning, it cut it down by 31% with no crop involved at all. So pruning is depressing on growth if you ignore crop. Pruning a vine will cut down the growth. On the other hand, over here, he didn't prune them at all, but he left all the crop on one, and he took off part of the crop, so he thinned off part of the crop here. So here's the effect with no crop on it. Here's the effect with a part of a crop, and the vine not pruned at all, knocked the wood growth down, and then leaving all the crop on really knocked it down further. So you see, you can slow down the growth of a vine by putting on crop. But when you put on crop and slow down the vine growth this way, you cause a lot of fairly, you still leave, if you prune it lightly, you still leave quite a few shoots, but the shoots are not so long. So that in this case, you get more crop, but you reduce the total growth, but you reduce the growth in the length of individual shoots. Over here, you have reduced the total weight of the pruning. If you pile these prunings up and weigh them, which is what he did, you've reduced the total growth. It may look like there's more growth because it's more vigorous, but you have less shoots. So that but if you weigh the leaves and the prunings from these, even though they look like they grew more, the total weight of new wood produced has been reduced. And it's this thing which this is one of the questions I gave you on the quiz is to outline that. Or diagram the type of growth you'd get. And you should have shown me a lot of little short shoots over here where you like prune lightly. This is not pruned at all, but where you prune lightly, you should have gotten lots of shoots with very short. So over here where you prune severely, you should have shown me only 8 or 10 very long, strong shoots. So then this is the whole basis of pruning is depressing on growth. Crop is depressing on growth. And when you put the two together, that is prune and crop, pruning and plus crop, then the vine really is depressed over what it might do if you just left it alone. Okay, next, let's see the next slide then. And the reason why this is depressing, of course, is say, I usually don't use notes to teach with, but this one I want to make sure I'm following right. And the reason why it is depressed is a matter of a reduction in leaf surface. I've been harping on the fact that the leaves have to be exposed to sun because that is the factory for production of energy, whatever you want to call it, sugar in the plant. And if you don't have the leaves, you don't have the plant. You don't have the machinery. And if you prune them severely, you can see what happens. This is, again, is in your text. You can see that back here on a severe prune run back here in May, the text I'll show you in a moment on data, there's a tenth of a pound of prunings here as compared to about 2 pounds or so up here on cane prune vines, which you're going to thin. So you have a tenth of a pound of leaves early in the season compared to about 2 pounds. But then you come out here, and my data, which I'll give you in a moment, will show the difference between severe prune and cane prune. This is about 1/4 of the amount of leaf surface out here June 24th, about 2 or 3 weeks after bloom. You've got still only got about 1/4 of the leaves on the severe prune as you do on the cane prune. And of course, the final thing out here is we forget about this no pruning plus thin because that's only on there for reference because you can't put up with that system. But here's cane pruning out here with about 12 pounds or more leaves at the end of the season compared to about probably 5 or 6 pounds. I can give you the exact figures when we turn on the lights here on the normal spur at the end of the season. So what the text points out and what I'm emphasizing here is that the vine's capacity is reduced by pruning because of reduced amount of leaf surface in total and the period of time over which it works, the length of time over which it works, because you can see that this cane prune thin vine had as many leaves way back here in June 24th as this normal spur had at the end of the season. So it had this, if you want to think of it in another quantitative way, which is the way I like to look at it, and isn't mentioned in the text, just consider the area under the curve and figure this volume, this acreage or area compared to this area, and consider those exactly proportional to the amount of sugar that's produced, which is the energy fuel for the vine. And that should give you a pretty good idea. This amount of area compared to this amount of area. And this aspect is not mentioned in text. He says the number of leaves and the length of time over which they work, but that really boils down to the area under the curve. Okay, I think we can have the lights now for me. And I'll give you just a little bit of this and the actual data of the weight of these leaves just for reference, because you don't have this data in the present text. Back in May 5th, which is, remember that bloom is going to take place about June 1st here at Davis, where this data was collected. So May 5th, the severe had a tenth of a pound of leaves, 1/10 pound of leaves. This is the weight of leaves. The normal spur had 4/10 of a pound. And the cane plus thinning, that is cane pruned plus some thinning. I didn't think ahead there. Had 1.9 pounds of leaves. This was on May 5th. Now out here at June 24th, which is one of the other points there where he took the data. On June 24th, the severe only had 1.8 pounds. The normal had 3.3. And the cane plus thinning had 7.4 pounds. And then out at October 15th, which roughly is the end of the effective use of these leaves, the severe had 6.7 pounds. The normal had 7.6. And the cane plus thinning had 14.9 pounds of leaves as a relative measure of leaf surface. So you see, The cane plus thinning had more leaves here in the last week of June than the severe ones had at the end of the growing season. So this is the real basis for this reduction in crop or vine growth, total vine growth, brought about by pruning. Hard to do, lose a sheet, you know. Okay. Now, pruning also affects, aside from the idea of pruning affecting the total growth. Everybody got this? Aside from the pruning affecting the total growth, you can get pruning affecting the quality, especially of these varieties which really require a lot of photosynthesis early in the season. Now, I'm going to get around later on through the course. We're going to talk a lot about this, but the grape flower is different from a peach or an almond flower, in that the almond flower is essentially mature and ready to break as soon as it gets its chilling requirement. It is fully formed and just has to have the chilling requirement. It'll open up and bang, there you are with all the flower parts and all ready to go. That's why the almond flower bursts out so suddenly, and it's one of the first ones you see in bloom. But when the grape goes into dormancy in the fall, it does not have anything approaching a normal flower development yet. All it has is just a few little embryonic or primordial cells which will indicate where the flower is going to develop. So that when the grape comes into bloom or into bud, you don't see even see the clusters until they're 6 inches long or so. And then you see this little cluster framework come out. And then it takes about 6 weeks for those embryonic nuclei of cells to develop into the flower. And during that time, they have to have good carbohydrate nutrition. Now, for most varieties, normal spur pruning, and there's enough reserve woodens within the vine, and with the foliage coming out, you can get the proper development of the flowers from the reserve food plus the carbohydrate that's produced in just spur pruning with a few leaves, as you saw here. But some varieties, such as Muscat of Alexandria, which is what I'm building up to here. Muscat is a variety that has weak flowers. And you have to baby them if you want to get them to set. In order to get good pollen, you've got to really give a high amount of leaf surface per cluster during this 6 weeks of development in order to get the flowers to develop well enough to grow up to be adults in order to go ahead and to set fruit. Now, in this pruning, if you give severe pruning, obviously you don't have the leaf surface. And if you don't have the leaf surface, the flowers are going to suffer. And here's some data that Winkler did I'll just give you the basic ingredients here, the most important points. But this was normal pruning. By normal then, that meant 2-3 buds. And under this, the weight of the cluster, the total weight of the cluster, was 0.43 pounds. 0.43 pounds. The percent normal berries. Percent normal berries. Now you've got a picture in your text of what we mean by unnormal clusters. Let me give you the page number. You can put it right with this, since on page 240, you'll see what we mean about normal and not normal clusters. Percent normal berries under this setup, 68% of them were normal berries. The rest of them were shot berries, which means small to intermediate sizes with no seeds, up to one or two seeds per berry. And with this, the pollen, the percent pollen germination which is a reflection of the carbohydrate nutrition, the development of the flowers, this had only 12% of the pollen germinated under normal pruning situation. And that accounts for why only 2/3 of the berries are normal and having seeds and normal size. Now, if you go to severe pruning, where you leave only one bud, the average weight was 0.37 pounds. The number of normal berries was 64, and the percent pollen germination was 10%. But now if you go to cane pruning, if you cane prune to leave lots of leaves, plus thinning of the fruit later on, the fruit averaged 1 pound per cluster, and 94% of the berries were of normal size, and the pollen that germinated came out to 42% of the pollen germinated. Now this is the big point. Look what a difference between these two, which is compared to this, and these two compared to this. All caused by that greatly increased leaf surface, or a greatly increased leaf to cluster ratio. The more leaves, the greater this leaf to cluster ratio, then the greater, the better the pollen was, and the nicer the clusters were in normal berries, and the larger the clusters were. Okay, we're out of time, I guess, for today. Okay.